this talk, I'll be covering the basics of inherited genetic variation and how it is measured. When we talk about measuring the genome, we're really focusing in on DNA. The DNA molecule is made up of two strands, which wind around one another to form that classic double helix. Each strand is made up of a sugar phosphate backbone, and attached to each of those sugars is a nitrogenous base, either adenine, thymine, cytosine, or guanine. Now, the two strands are held together by hydrogen bonds between complementary bases. Adenine will always bond with thymine, cytosine will always bond with guanine. From here, I'll refer to these bases as simply A, T, C, and G. In humans, our nuclear DNA is organized into chromosomes. In our somatic cells, we have 46 chromosomes, 23 pairs, which are homologs except for the sex chromosomes in males who have XY. Although we have 46 chromosomes, because of that pairing, the human genome sequence is essentially the haploid genome. The human genome has about 3 billion base pairs across 23 chromosomes, but most of those are the same for all people. Only about 0.1% differ across individuals. So a genetic variant is going to be any specific region that can differ between genomes. Now, each person has DNA from two biological parents, a maternal and a paternal source. Each of those have two strands. So there are a number of different ways to name those strands, top, bottom, plus, minus, forward, reverse, etc. But I'm not going to get into that here. I've arbitrarily labeled the strands in this figure just to illustrate the idea. When we measure DNA, only one of those strands needs to be measured because the complementary strand will be known through the bonding of the bases. If we focus on only that top strand, the alleles, or versions of this genetic variant, is going to be either a C or an A. So a person's genotype is the alleles from each chromosome. So in this example, let's say that the top strand is measured, then person one is going to have the genotype CC. And person two will have the genotype AC at this locus. In this example, the alleles are unambiguous because the paired base is different to the alternate allele. So C will pair with G, but C's alternate allele is A. A will pair with T, but the alternate allele to A is C. Which one is called the reference and which one is called the alternate depends in part on the programs that we're using. However, if the alleles at a locus are the same as those that are complementary across DNA strands, then the variant is composed of ambiguous alleles. So at this particular locus, we can have either an A or a T, but the paired base of A is T, and the paired base of T is A. So the alternate allele is also the paired allele, which is a problem because not all genotyping technologies measure the same strand. And this can make harmonizing data difficult and complicated. There are some ways that we can work around it, but it's worth being aware of. So far, our example has been of a variant with only two alleles, a biallelic variant. While this is the most common type of genetic variant, some loci are multiallelic. So this is an example of a locus that might have an A or a T or a G. So this person is an example of a genotype that's a TT, this person is a TA, and this person is a TG. Our example has also been of a genetic variant where only a single base pair has differed. So a single nucleotide polymorphism, or SNP. SNPs are the most common type of genetic variant, but there are others. When looking at this figure, the chromosome on the left is representing the reference genome. So the alternative allele may have additional bases, extra bases. That would be an insertion. It may be missing some bases. That would be a deletion. It may be a stretch that's being repeated. A duplication. There may be a stretch that's been inverted. It can also be a stretch that has been transposed and moved to a different location on the chromosome or translocated completely to another chromosome. After SNPs, indels are the most frequent type of genetic variant. Indels are short insertions and deletions of less than 1,000 bases in length. Generally speaking, the longer the sequence that is involved in structural variation, then the less commonly it is observed. When speaking of common genetic variation, we're often referring to genetic variants where the less frequent allele is present in at least 1% of the population. So while a rare variant is going to be less frequently observed than that. However, that 1% is very arbitrary. Now, measuring rare variation is substantially more expensive than measuring common variation. When it comes to measuring the genome, To sequence the whole of a person's genome is very costly, although the costs have been reducing over time and reducing dramatically from millions of dollars to just under $1,000 US. This is still pretty pricey, especially when we consider power and the sample sizes that we probably need. So researchers may choose to sequence just specific sections of the genome, or they may just choose to sequence the exons, the bases that encode for genes. The human genome is too long to sequence from start to finish. Instead, it's broken up into short sections that can each be read. The number of times any nucleotide is read is the read depth, so higher read depth will tend to give greater accuracy. There's also different read lengths, so for longer structural variants, a longer read length might be required to capture those data accurately. Once read, these little pieces of DNA are aligned against a reference sequence. Once we have them all aligned, we then have a whole genome sequence of an individual and can identify points along it that are either the same or different to the reference, or the same or different to other individuals. However, if your research question is about common genetic variation, then we can acquire this data much more cheaply. This is typically done with Sniff chips. These chips have genotyping arrays that are designed to target specific loci from across the genome. As with sequencing, the DNA is chopped up into short stretches. These arrays then have probes that are designed to capture a targeted locus, and the probe will fluoresce a specific color if its target allele is bonded to it. For each locus, the probes for different alleles will fluoresce a different color, and then those colors will be translated into genotypes. From those measured genotypes, the alleles at other locations in the genome can be imputed, and this will give us data across the genome about common genetic variation that we can subsequently use in analyses.